Hello and welcome to Series 2 of Let's Go Further, a podcast from the Skills and Education Group that challenges the way we think about skills and education. I'm Joe McLaughlin, Foundation Manager at the Group, and in this series I'm speaking to people from inside and outside the education sector about equity, diversity and inclusion. In this episode we're talking about the role of religion in education, and joining me is the Reverend Nigel Genders, Chief Education Officer of the Church of England, which is the largest provider of faith-based schools in the UK and has representation in around 80% of colleges. I just wanted to begin with a broad question and just ask if you can tell us a little bit about the church's role in education in the UK historically.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those questions that could go back as long as you want, but right from the beginning of the church's kind of life, really, has been an involvement with education. So in this country, you can trace that back to 597 AD, when Augustine came over and brought Christianity to Britain, and the kind of sense that education was part of that movement right from the beginning led to the founding of schools, King's Scholar Schools and things like that. But I guess the main turning point was in 1811, when the charity which I work for, the National Society, was founded and became a movement for mass education for the poor and disadvantaged in the country, and led to the kind of development of thousands of schools that were not for the wealthy, rich families who could afford education for their boys, as it would have been then, but was mass education for the poor and the disadvantaged, with a vision that every child should have an opportunity to access education. And, you know, the state joined in with that as a good idea some 50 years later. So it wasn't until 1850, 1860 that the state really got involved in that. And then the subsequent history is one where the church and the state have kind of managed that relationship and found a way to ensure that both partners could play a part in education. Probably the kind of key moment was the 1944 Education Act, where that settlement about who provides what in terms of church education and state education was kind of established. So there's a very quick potted history, Joe, in terms of the last couple of hundred years at least.
And where does that leave you now? How many schools are you working with, or how many learners are you guiding?
Yeah, so in the school sector, that means that the church now across England and Wales provides just over 4,800 schools. That's just over 1 million children are in a Church of England school every day of the week. So of those in the English context, of those 4,700 schools in England, 4,500 of them are primary, 200 and something are secondary. So we've been really very majority focused on primary schools. But so 800,000 young people in a Church of England primary school, that's one in four of all primary schools, and about 200,000 in a Church of England secondary school.
And kind of thinking about where faith meets the national curriculum, kind of what does that look like day to day? I suppose what I'm asking is, how would a church school differ from a state school?
Yeah, and a really interesting question, because our schools are schools with a religious character. They are schools like any other maintained state school. They deliver the broad curriculum. They're there to do the kind of the whole of the educational journey, and yet they have a particular emphasis in terms of ensuring that the ethos and the character of that school is one where the characteristics of it are such that the collective worship, the religious education, the way the curriculum is treated, are all through the lens of our deep Christian understanding. And yeah, that means that there'll be particular points where you'd say, so the collective worship syllabus or the RE curriculum might be slightly different in a church school than a non-church school. But actually what we want in all of our schools is for that Christian character and ethos to run through the whole of the life of the school. Like I often use the metaphor of, the writing through a stick of rock, that wherever you cut the life of the school, you should be able to recognize that the impact of the character and the ethos on the whole life of the school is one that brings a real sense of flourishing to that school community.
And just thinking about that ethos and that character, in kind of preparation for today, I was reading over the church's vision for education, and the mission statement there was a deeply Christian, serving the common good view of education. And I'd just be curious to hear your thoughts on what is deeply Christian in this context, and what is the common good?
Yeah, and we worked very hard on that strapline, because when we were producing our vision, we were really clear that we didn't want to produce a vision for Church of England schools. We wanted to produce the Church of England's vision for education. And I think there's a big difference between those things, is that we do provide a lot of schools, but our vision for education is one which we think is one which can be relevant to all schools and to every aspect of education. And so we went for the kind of the strapline of deeply Christian, serving the common good, because we want to be really clear about our deep convictions and our heritage and the theology that underpins our thinking and what a school's Christian vision is. And that's why we worked really hard on four core themes around wisdom. I mean, wisdom is not a word that you tend to hear in the education sector very often, but actually what we're interested in is how we educate children and young people in a way which helps them to become wise and to learn how to live wisely. Wisdom and hope, you know, giving a sense of, you know, failure isn't the end of the story. When people have difficult times, there's always a chance for a fresh start, and a hope and aspiration which gives a sense of a future hope and certainty. Of community and how we live well as in communities with each other. They're all at the heart of Christian theology, the kind of the dignity and the respect that we give to people. So all of those themes are really the underpinning deep Christian theological convictions that we have. We want to be really clear about, you know, where they've come from, how that depth of Christian thinking influences our vision. And yet, to make sure that it's not about just providing schools for the faithful or faith schools or whatever terminology gets used, but it's going back to what I was describing in terms of our roots in 1811. It's about education for all. So our schools, you know, we pride ourselves on being church schools for the whole community, and we're about enabling the whole community to flourish. And so when we say the common good, that's what we're talking about. We're saying that we want the whole of education to be something which the whole of society can benefit from. And so we see our role as supporting that common good, not just being a kind of subset for those who particularly think that faith is an interesting thing for them. I mean, some of the things I've been talking about, you know, earlier today and during this week have been around how we encourage, you know, those children in those in schools to then play their part in society and become courageous advocates for social justice or racial justice or whatever the issue might be, to make sure that they're able to really play their full part in society.
So I wanted to turn now and look a little more at the sector that we work closest with, which is, you know, the further education and skills sector. And I just wanted to ask if you could set the scene for us, kind of how does the church currently get involved with further education colleges or skills providers?
Yeah, and it's obviously a different scenario and different context to the school sector, because there isn't any kind of systematic involvement or systemic involvement in that we don't provide FE colleges in the way that we provide schools. So in the school sector, the fact that we've provided those schools over those hundreds of years means that we're tied in at a governance level and in terms of the ownership of the school site and the land and all of those sorts of things. That's not the case in FE, and yet we know that, you know, there are twice as many 16 to 18 year olds in FE colleges as there are in all the entirety of the school six forms put together. So although we're not tied in at the governance or the kind of the statutory level within the FE sector, then we know that our vision for the common good must include FE colleges as well. So we see colleges as being real partners in that community building. And it tends to be on a much more informal basis, therefore, in FE than it is in the school setting. And we, you know, there are examples where that informal nature is such that churches will come alongside their college leaders and assist with things like, I don't know, the prevent anti-extremism agenda would have been one example. Or how does the church help the college in resourcing spiritual and moral and social and cultural education? What does it do about building community cohesion? But it tends to be on a much more informal kind of case-by-case basis in terms of, you know, understanding the local context, rather than the more systemic kind of rooted basis that we have in the school sector, through particularly through the governance of those schools.
So what you've just said there kind of reminds me of a lot of what the church's recent review of involvement in FE colleges, the Vocation, Transformation and Hope review, stated, which was at a really simple level, there isn't enough as engagement as you'd like to see, given the sort of size and scale of colleges. And that review set the target that within the next 5 years, each diocese would seek an active partnership with each of its FE and sixth form colleges. A couple of years in now since that publication, how is that five-year plan going?
Yeah, it's been perhaps a bit slower than we'd anticipated. I mean, we landed that report just in the, most of the work was done pre-pandemic, but the report landed right at the beginning of the global pandemic. And we recognise that colleges have had quite a lot to think about and to do in that time. But the commitment to from the church of working with FE colleges in this way is really still as resounding as it was when we wrote the report. It's about how we ensure that at that local level we're able to build those partnerships. We're not at the point at the moment in terms of having a kind of a group of colleges that want to come together and work in a more formal way in with the church feeling, but there's a real definite passion for and local commitment to working at an individual level. And that's kind of been done through chaplaincy. And I mean, the chaplaincy is one of the kind of key things which the church provides to FE colleges. And we're really keen to see that develop. And we're beginning to do some work in that area and one or two other areas around, apprenticeships, for example, or some of the green skills agenda. And seeing the relationship with those colleges develop in that way is something which is happening on a case-by-case basis in different dioceses. But we were quite bold about the kind of the aspiration to then form a wider group of colleges. I think we're still a few years off that being a reality, but we're very sure about the individual relationships, particularly in the area of chaplaincy, for example.
So would you say then that the kind of the most positive work, the most successful work in terms of partnership building or outreach to colleges has been around that pastoral support, the more sort of the socially minded side of things rather than the actually explicitly educational side of things?
Yeah, and I think that you talked about the 80% figure earlier as you were introducing it, Joe, and we know that there are huge numbers of colleges where the church, the local church, is engaged with them through chaplaincy. What that tends to be at the moment is voluntary, part-time chaplaincy. Where, and again, that's slightly different to you would experience if you went into a church in a secondary school, for example, where there'd probably be a full-time paid chaplain as part of the school staff. So we're starting from a basis which is much more part-time voluntary chaplaincy. But how colleges are valuing that role as chaplains are able to get alongside students and support them through what's been a pretty difficult and challenging time, particularly in terms of people's mental health and well-being and some of the pastoral support that the students are able to access. We're seeing a real appetite for, well, how do we create chaplaincy which is much more formal and sustainable, and the church is beginning to invest in ensuring that those kinds of opportunities for chaplaincy are ones that can develop and become more substantive kind of full-time roles with much greater therefore impact in terms of the ability to be able to engage with students across the college's community.
So you spoke briefly there about the kind of the benefits that colleges are seeing from chaplaincy, although it's hard to measure at the moment because it's part-time and on a voluntary basis in most cases. Are there any dangers or challenges that you see kind of relating to this role? So the idea that they can be independent, relatively independent within the system, but not part of the system. Is there a danger or a risk there that you have to manage or see on a day-to-day basis?
Yeah, I mean, I think that one of the joys of chaplaincy and why it's so successful as a model in educational settings is that students can talk to the chaplain as someone who's not marking their work or assessing them, or you know, they're not connected to the kind of the life of the college in quite that same formal way. So it gives a freedom to be much more open and to have that kind of development of a relationship. That's great. That's a really important and fundamental thing about chaplaincy. The danger, I suppose, is that if it is kind of part-time, voluntary, ad hoc, you don't get the consistency of approach. And so, or even the profile, I suppose, which is needed in order for students really to be able to access that service effectively. So it just becomes part of the other wider leadership of the college in terms of the relationship that the chaplain has with students in terms of it being on a formal educational basis. I think it does nevertheless need to be hardwired into the college's life so that in terms of profile and the ability for the chaplain to have a space and a place where students know where to reach them and to access them is really important. So it's kind of keeping that, yes, the kind of minister without portfolio is a good analogy. You don't want to be responsible for kind of the assessment of the students in that way, but having a clear role within the wider strategic leadership of the college, I think is something which we found certainly in the school setting brings real added value to the chaplain's role, because it's not just about the students actually, really important on that basis, but we find that our chaplains are also often there for staff as well, and for being able to help be a listening ear to staff and to be able to help them in some of the complexities of the things that they're managing. To have that kind of chaplaincy approach for staff and students is really important, and so therefore being, as I say, hardwired into the kind of the structure of the college is really important for that purpose.
So I just wanted to take a step back away from the kind of the day-to-day interactions with colleges, growth of chaplaincies, growth of partnerships, that kind of thing. And I wanted to ask you about the power of vocation in Christian thought. So I appreciate it won't necessarily mean skill development or job-based learning or kind of more practical learning as it's often used in our sector, in our area. But I was wondering, do you see an overlap between the kind of Christian terminology and the work of colleges?
Oh, for sure, yeah. And I mean, you reference our report that we produced in 2021 around vocation, transformation and hope. And vocation, absolutely fundamental to our understanding of what education is about and why we want to engage in this sector in such a clear way. So, every person has unique gifts and abilities and motivations. That's kind of what is fundamental to our Christian understanding of who we are as human beings. And God calls us as who we are to be the unique people that we are. That's fundamentally what vocation's about, as far as I can understand it. We're called to use our gifts in the service of others. We're called to ensure that what we do in our lives is paying attention to kind of who we are as individuals. So yes, colleges are absolutely at the heart of preparing people for future careers and for education that enables them to achieve in particular areas of the different what we call vocational courses. But that's about actually preparing them to be and equipping them to be human beings who can both aspire and use their gifts and talents and cope with their struggles and be the human beings that they need to be to actually live out their life in a way which is a life in all its fullness, as we say in our vision. So further education and what colleges are doing is fundamentally about vocation, and Christianity is fundamentally about vocation. So we see the two go together in that way.
Recognizing that then, because I think the phrase you used there was kind of the fullness of life, or the kind of the full human being, as it were, so that when you go to get educated, it's not just about a qualification, it's about a whole range of perspectives that you learn, that you develop. What do you hope that the kind of the church gains in return, in response? Kind of what would be a success for you, I suppose? What would be a benefit for you?
I think that it's fundamentally about children and young people in the college context knowing that actually the church wants them to thrive and to flourish and to find that fullness of life which I was referring to. to ensure that, you know, that they see themselves fully as being part of what the church's story is about, which is about finding meaning and purpose and that kind of deeper sense of a growing sense of who they are in terms of their own identity and value and worth and self-worth. And so for the church, I mean, the church nationally, as the Church of England, we've set out an aspiration to be younger and more diverse. We know that, you know, go back to what I was saying earlier about the sheer numbers of students in FE colleges, more than double that are in schools in terms of the 16 to 18 age group. So if the church really wants to engage with society and enable young people to find that fullness of life, well, you know, what better place to relate to them than in further education colleges? So we're about ensuring that every young person can fulfill their God-given potential. For some, that will mean finding meaning and purpose in a kind of deep and personal and growing relationship with God. But go back to what I was saying about the common good, our hope is that for all, that sense of self-worth and vocation will bring the hope and the transformation that enables them to be who God wants them to be. And that's our purpose. That's why it is about, in the FE sector as well as in the school sector, about being deeply Christian, serving the common good, because we're fundamentally wanting to engage with this sector in a way which enables that common good to bring transformation to the world in which we live. I often boldly say, as I talk to school leaders, that the business that we're in is the formation of children and young people for the transformation of the world. It's a massive undertaking, and boy does our world need transforming when you see the complexity of the world in which we live. And so our engagement, whether it be in school or in college or in university, is about ensuring that we enable that transformation to happen for every person and every person's life. And that's what we're seeking to do by being more involved in further education, just as we are through schools and higher education.
And so that commitment then, that sounds like a long-term commitment for you. That'll be something that you'll be working on with the church into the future.
Yeah, it is very much a long-term commitment. And we know that, you know, the political cycle is such that, you know, since we published that report in 2021, I think there have been 5 Secretary of State for Education in that time. And each comes with a kind of their own sense of priorities. But what we always say is that the Church of England, has been here in terms of our role in education for the last couple of 100 years in this formal ways. And we want to be here for the next 200 years, continuing to have this emphasis. And so we are into long-term commitment. That is exactly the DNA that the church brings to this. It's not about a political cycle. It's about a long-term commitment. And just as we've been committed in the school sector for that period of time, we want the church to engage in further education colleges and in the FE sector in a way which shows that long-term commitment to the fantastic work that those colleges are doing to bring the hope and aspiration to young people to grow and to fulfill their purposes. And the church is committed to being in that game for the long term, and will seek to develop the relationships on a college to college basis in a way which enables that commitment to be understood and to appreciated and to be developed, and will be one that goes on for years to come. So the Church of England's, you know, aspiration for younger and more diverse, it's set out as part of its 10-year plan, but it's much more than 10 years. It's about our commitment to children and young people in this nation for generations to come.
Thank you to my guest, the Reverend Nigel Genders, and to you for listening. We hope you enjoyed the conversation and that it's got you thinking about the connections between religion, education and wider society. This episode is the last in the current series of Let's Go Further, but all episodes from this series and the first series are available wherever you receive your podcasts. And you can keep up with us at the Skills and Education Group on Twitter, at Skills Edu Group, or search Skills and Education Group on LinkedIn and Facebook. Thanks for listening. I'll see you next time, and let's go further together.